Hello, kings, queens, nerds, and geeks. Powder Milk here, and welcome back to Fallout Equestria, chapter 37.3. Now, guys, you're back to the Shadow of the Ministries. This one is about Twilight Sparkle. So we're going to learn a little bit more about the Ministry of Arcane Science, which is I'm pretty interested about the outcomes, because we already know that Twilight invented the taint. And she created what Trixie is today. She created all the mutated creatures of Fallout. So, there you go. She basically started the mutations. God. I would like to see what the memory orb will be about this time. Because I like to know all the fates of all the ponies. I want to know them all. You might find out the fate of Rainbow Dash, which is in one of these. I don't know which. Hold on, now I'm gonna look. Scrolling. Can I get my mouse? So, oh, Pinkie Pie is after that one. And then after that, then it's Rainbow Dash, and then finally Rarity. So we're gonna find out a little bit of all of them. So we already know the possible location. We might know the possible location of the Black Book. So, anyway, let's get back to the story.
I groaned. My whole body hated me for still being alive. My headache had ratcheted up to the point where it was hard to think straight, and my right foreleg itched horribly beneath my pit buck. Everything else in my body just hurt. Too much physical trauma in too short a period of time. My body was crying out for me to stop. Lost count of how many times I've been shot, beaten, and poisoned at this point. Wounds that would normally take weeks or months to heal were instead fixed as I drowned myself in potions of magical healing, letting them mend everything and then throwing myself right back into the fray. Pain had become as much a companion for me as my friends had. But these things, the broadcasters, the pink cloud, they were so much worse. They tore me apart in ways a bullet never could, attacking everywhere at once. Attacking my magic, attacking my brain. Even with potions of healing and restoration, I couldn't help but feel that deep and permanent damage was being done. I wasn't going to live to a ripe old age. One day, everything I'd been putting my body through would catch up to me, and I would die young. Part of me wanted to quit while I was still ahead, but every part of me knew that I could never quit. Quitting was surrender. I couldn't even rest, as much as I knew I should. Every day I rested was a day that others whom I could have saved would die. If I'd rested even an extra hour, the Unzebra would have been slain by those bloodwings. If I'd rested an hour less, I would have been able to save his friend as well. Pain, I could handle, as long as I was alive and still able to make a difference. I wondered if this was how Steelix felt. I had saved him. He hadn't been moving, but I knew he couldn't be dead. The lightning may have rendered him unconscious or knocked his armor spell matrix offline. Either way, if I hadn't gotten to him, the Alicorns would have. The broadcaster wouldn't have saved him, although it definitely bought him time. Thank the goddesses I at least managed to levitate the liquid pink sludge away before I had inhaled any of it. Thank Celestian Luna that I'd drunk healing potions minutes earlier and didn't fall into that pool with open wounds from those Canterlot dragon hatchlings. I couldn't tell if I was being supremely lucky or supremely unlucky. And now that I thought of it, I'd come out of this with a new weapon against the Alicorns. Granted, it was one that was indiscriminately lethal, but it had to be possible to use the broadcasters to my advantage. But first I needed to... Where the hell was I? Calamity? Velvet? I was alone. Steelhoofs. Pyrolite. Completely alone. I was laying on a soft cushioned bed. I tried to sit up, and a thunderclap went off in my pounding head, knocking me back down and leaving tears in my eyes. I brought up my eye sword Sparkle, not remembering to turn it off, and scanned the medical warnings. I needed to drink a super restoration potion, possibly several. And painkillers. I certainly needed painkillers. But I didn't have any. I didn't have anything. No weapons. No supplies. I vaguely remember dropping our weapons and supply packs when I went chasing after steel hooves. I groaned at the thought of little Macintosh laying abandoned out in that field. It felt like I'd lost a friend. Hopefully Velvet Remedy had grabbed everything before following us, but doing so would have taxed her limited telekinesis, and I couldn't imagine her prioritizing weapons when she had steel hooves to care for. But wait, I wasn't wearing my utility barding either, and I definitely didn't strip down before my unintentional swim. I felt truly naked as I realized I didn't even have my hacking tools. Looking around, I was in a library. No, an Athenium. And a big one. Bigger even than Twilight Sparkle's Athenium and Ten Pony Tower. I remembered the recording that Amaj had played for me, Rarity talking to Twilight, mentioning something of sending ideologically incompatible books to the Ponyville Library. If only I could spare the time to just sit and read. Ah, you are awake. The voice startled me. It was Urbane, the voice of a gentle stallion. I looked around, wincing as the pain in my head amplified with the sudden movement, blurring my vision.
What?
Good morning, madam. Morning. Oh, goddesses, I've been asleep all night? And no pony had found me? This was unspeakably bad. Who are you? I asked the mysterious stranger. Where am I?
Wordsworth at your service, ma'am. You are in Twilight Sparkle's Athenium, ma'am.
I blinked away tears, turning my head more slowly as I began to mentally hone in on the source of the voice. There he was. Or it, rather. A mechanical owl.
Owlicious?
A fancier version of the one I'd seen following the merchant who had set up in the remains of Trixie's cottage. I remembered fighting owls similar to this one in the Ministry Morale Hub in Manhattan, too. But this one looked far more sophisticated, and far more lovingly crafted, down to the bronze filigree of feathers. Who... what are you? At least this mechanical owl didn't seem hostile.
Wordsworth, ma'am. Twilight Sparkle's junior assistant.
How did I get here?
Well, ma'am, the owl said, sounding embarrassed. When a mare and a stallion love each other, or have made certain binding contracts...
I interrupted quickly. Into this room, I mean. The pony in the back of my head was blinking. Certain binding contracts. But then, this was Canterlot, home of royalty and nobility.
You were teleported here, ma'am. Security protocols. The Ministry is under lockdown. All visitors and staff are teleported to their proper areas, and intruders are remanded to secure containment areas.
Cells, he meant. The itching under my pit buck was driving me crazy. Further questioning revealed that the lockdown had been running constantly since the environmental catastrophe over 200 years ago. Furthermore, all the teleportation zones were inside the Ministry building, but Wadsworth couldn't tell me where any of the others had been sent. Nor could the owl give a satisfactory explanation of how I had raided teleportation into Twilight Sparkle's private library. I got the sense that the security system wasn't functioning quite the way it was supposed to. It had degraded under centuries of continuous operation. I was probably lucky I hadn't been teleported into a bookshelf or a wall. And what about my clothing?
All foreign objects bearing trace amounts of toxins were teleported to sanitation.
I really hoped that didn't mean incineration. I would like them back, please.
Certainly, ma'am.
Wadsworth responded pleasantly.
Sanitation has been completed. They will be returned to the wardrobe immediately.
Another fear shot through me. If this magical security system stripped me of my armor, then would it try to strip Steelo's armor off of him? Or could it recognize something melded to him as integral? That was, assuming Velvet Remedy was able to get him to the safety of the Ministry building.
Oh no.
I conjured the alarming image of Velvet running into the Ministry, levitating Steelhoves behind her, only to be teleported away, leaving Steelhoves helpless outside on the doorstep.
That would mean Steelhoves might not be... Oh god, oh no. Oh god. Steelhoves is like one of my favorite characters, come on, don't do this to me! Please.
If he was inside, and alive, for those definitions of alive that include Canterlot ghouls, then he was separated like the rest of us. My friends could be anywhere in the building. Again, I remembered that they had all night to try to find me. The fact that they hadn't most likely meant they were in bad shape. I moaned and tried to sit up again. My EFS was still flashing health alerts to me. I lifted my pip buck to check the auto map, wishing all my friends were pip bucks so I could just locate their tags. Of course, that's exactly the problem that got me into this whole mess a month and a half ago, wasn't it? I looked at my foreleg and stopped breathing. I wasn't wearing my pip buck anymore. Where the metal device should stop and my flesh should start, they didn't. Instead, they melded seamlessly into one another. I felt sick looking at it. I had been so casual to admit the possible danger before, but now that it actually happened, I felt a sense of violation and loss that I couldn't explain. I wasn't me anymore. I dropped back onto the bed and curled up, crying. Wadsworth, I whimpered several minutes later as I tried to fight back the hollow feeling in my heart. I need medical supplies. Any painkiller, healing, and restoration potions you can give me.
You would not prefer to use the autonomous healing booth, ma'am.
The what now? Okay. Sure. Where is this healing booth?
Never again.
I felt better physically than I had in weeks. Psychologically, I was shaken to the point of collapse. The healing booth was a solid metal tube, barely bigger than a pony. Stepping into it had been like stepping into my own coffin. The air had been stifling, even before the door slid closed behind me, plunging me into darkness. I had never felt claustrophobia before. If anything, I was prone to sudden onsets of agoraphobia. But in that metal casket, in that absolute darkness, with the sounds that horrible thing made. And then I started to feel magical energies probing me, washing over me like some sort of slimy alien massage from an invisible and horrible creature. Never, ever again. Even though my body felt better, I knew I would have nightmares for weeks. I could already anticipate waking in cold sweat, finding the dream terror of being trapped endlessly in that autonomous healing station. Did it work perfectly as it was supposed to?
Fear of healing stations.
And of course couldn't drag me back into one if I was on the edge of death. I shuddered to imagine the horror one of those things could inflict if it wasn't functioning properly, if it malfunctioned or suffered degradation from the cloud. I felt myself shiver. The walls were covered in soft, velvety cloth, burgundy in color with sparkling accents, that gave the hallway a rich, luxurious feel. Oil paintings hung on the walls. I passed a spot where a large oval of darker cloth betrayed the removal of what had once been a portrait. Ahead of me, the hallway ended in the door marked Spell Testing. Somebody had scrawled the words, Spell in a Box, on the door in what looked like dried blood. At the end of the X, the blood streaked down to meet a dark stain on the floor. Oh, that's not a good sign at all, I muttered to myself. I was appropriately creeped out. As I approached, I could faintly hear the hissing sound coming from behind it, like 100 dying snakes. I stopped, psyching myself up, taking deep breaths, and opened the door from a distance with my magic. Through it, I could see another door at the far end of the laboratory. One more deep breath, and I broke into a run. I galloped through the doorway into the lab, my ears filling with the sound of static. The headache that the healing station had rid me of returned with a passion, accompanied by a familiar pressure in my horn. I didn't have a firearm with me, so there was no way to take out the speaker. I just had to get through the lab and out of its range before it could kill me. Blood began to tint my vision as I reached the opposite door. It was locked. I telekinetically fumbled at the lock, the pain in my horn escalating, the deadly effect of the broadcaster tearing at my brain. I'd spent nearly an hour in the healing station, and for the first time since leaving Tenpony, I'd actually felt very healthy. I had been allowed to enjoy that sensation for less than 40 minutes. I unlocked the door and pushed it open, stepping out of the lab and outside the speaker's kill range. I panted, leaning against a rail, blinking away blood and tears. Then I looked down into a grand hall lined with sweeping staircases. Below me was a fountain similar to the one in Homage's foyer, only the statue here was of two identical unicorn mares frolicking. On the walls of each side were oil paintings, including a royal portrait of a smiling green-coated unicorn mare with a darker green mane. Hanging opposite was what appeared to be the same mare, only with colors from coat and mane swapped. "Velvet?" I called out. "Calamity! Any pony home?" My voice echoed in the stately and empty corridor. At the end of the grand hall, in the crux of multiple stairwells that spread out like butterfly wings, was a very important-looking, high-arched set of double doors flanked by unicorn busts. I was unsurprised that they were locked. I was very surprised when the moment I started to pick the locks, two magical energy turrets had dropped down and started shooting at me. I was immediately thankful that my armored utility barding had been returned as I spun and dove over the railing of the nearest stairwell, catching myself in levitation as soon as I was behind cover. I supposed I should consider myself lucky that my barding hadn't been submerged in the pink pool long enough to fuse to my body, and that my hacking and repair tools had likewise not been fused together, or otherwise warped into uselessness. Having my pip buck melted to my arm was a brutal enough blow, and I'd never wanted to take it off. Yeah, that would have made my relationship with Omelette really difficult, My Little Pony teased. I shushed her in annoyance and turned my focus to unlocking the door from safety. It was proving a tough lock, but I'd faced one tougher already today. I saw a purple flash from above me and heard a crackle. This door had magical defenses beyond just the turrets. If I had been trying this with my trusty screwdriver and bobby pin, I would be in a bad state. Click. Yes. I eased myself to the floor, focusing my attention on the fountain. The glow of my magic washed over the pooled water. I lifted the water into the air and used it to shield me overhead as I galloped back up the stairs. The magical energy turret spotted me and started to fire, each shot evaporating part of my shield in a puff of steam. By the time I got through the door, there was barely enough left to fill a wastebasket. I was so thankful there weren't more turrets waiting inside. Instead, I found myself in what I quickly deduced was the head researcher's office. Bookshelves, filing cabinets, tapestries, arcane spellwork tables. The room was laid out symmetrically around a carpet with an intricate star pattern of alternating colors. Two rather impressive desks faced one another, with oil paintings of the same green ponies hung on the walls behind them. Not portraits this time, but full paintings which allowed me to see their matching cutie marks, spiraling magical sparks intertwined with each other. On each desk sat a terminal next to a glass placard with a name sealed inside, made out of sparkling glitter. Gestalt and Mosaic. Trotting around the desks, I spotted the weapon display case and several ammo boxes. Inside the display case was a magical plasma rifle and a multi-gem magical energy shotgun. The latter reminded me of Dawn's gun. It took me less than a minute to make them mine, though. I was tempted to run back upstairs and shoot the damn death speaker. I wasn't very good with magical energy weapons, but I was sure I could take out a stationary target at close range. Moving to Mosaic's terminal, I drew out my tools and began to hack into it. Mercifully, the pink saturated water that bound my pitbuck to me did not seem to impair its functioning. StableTech didn't fool around when they made pitbucks. The devices had the durability somewhere between steel hose and a soul jar. "Velvet?" I asked as I pushed open the door I had just unlocked. The chamber inside was pitch black, and my voice echoed off walls both far and strange.
"Little Pip?"
A voice called back from the darkness, sounding weak and relieved. A light flared, illuminating Velvet Remedy's horn, then her eyes, mane, and tail. Her charcoal coat seemed to blend into the void around her. "Over here." I lit up my own horn, guiding her to me. She got up shakily and trotted quickly towards me.
"Thank the goddesses,"
she whispered as she reached me, nuzzling my face.
I was trapped here for so long. Alone. Trapped."
She had said that twice. I didn't need explanation. My lovely songbird friend had once again found herself caged and alone. She was trembling.
"It's okay, Velvet. I'm sorry it took so long to find you. What happened?"
Okay, first of all, I want to say, what the fuck is going on? Because I have no idea what happened. Obviously, where is the relay? So far, we've got Pip, who now has her Pip Buck, abuse to her forehoof. And now they find Remedy, Velvet Remedy.
Where am I? Is Calamity okay? Is Pyolite? What happened to Stelos? I had him right with me.
I lifted a hoof to her muzzle, quieting the flood of questions. Then I wrapped her in an embrace. I wasn't surprised by how she folded into it. I was surprised how quickly she regained her composure, though, pushing me away.
Thank you, little Pip, but the others are who are important right now.
I nodded and began to fill her in. Thanks to the terminals of Mosaic and Gestalt, I had a pretty good idea of where every pony was now. Velvet Remedy had been trapped in one of the megaspell casting chambers that filled this entire floor. Stelos was probably in the Arcane Technologies research lab 2 floors below us. Calamity was somewhere in the basement, which included prisoner containment, ministry security, high security storage, and, incongruously, the ministry's kitchen. Pyrolite had never been registered as entering the building. Either she had never gotten inside, or the security system had a phoenix-sized hole. Something had apparently gone seriously wrong in the basement. All the security systems had been rerouted to the terminals of Mosaic and Gestalt, and communication with the basement had been severed. The Unicorn Twins had not only been the head researchers from the Ministry of Arcane Sciences in this hub, but for the Ministry as a whole. It appeared they were regularly left in command of this Canterlot hub, particularly while Twilight Sparkle was away at the Ministry hub in Manhattan. As best I could tell, they weren't actually in the Ministry when the lockdown started, but I was able to lift it by issuing simultaneous commands from both of their terminals. Thank you again, telekinesis. As I finished telling Velvet Remedy what I knew, she looked at me curiously.
Why didn't you have Wadsworth send you all of our equipment?
I blinked. Then face-offed.
Oh, because I'm not a clever pony.
We had to find sanitation as well. Damn it, this just got worse and worse.
Well, why don't we run up and ask him before heading down farther?
Oh, well, that would probably be easier, wouldn't it? I dropped everything I was floating except for the 2 magical weapons and dashed into the lab, the static doom of several broadcasters ripping apart my head and driving spikes into my horn. It was a repeat of 3 floors above, only this time I had a magical shotgun. I spun, looking around for speakers, radios of skeletons with broadcasters attached to their civilian model pit bucks. As I found one, I fired at the pit buck clad foreleg of a unicorn skeleton. The short-range multi-blast of magical energy turned bone and broadcaster to slag. One shot missed the table radio completely, hitting a chemistry set 3 tables over, causing an explosion of glass and colored steam. The second slagged the radio, killing its lethal output. Still, static. One more. My vision was red. I could feel blood trickling down my ears. Grenades were going off inside of my head. I spotted the second broadcaster and lifted the multi-gem magical shotgun, pulling the trigger. Nothing. The damn thing was recharging. In a panic, I fled to the far side of the lab. I pressed myself into the corner, breathing a sigh of relief as the vices crushing my horn and skull vanished. That last yard of space was outside of the danger zone, luckily. I floated up the magical energy rifle, took careful aim and fired. And continued to fire, reloading twice until I finally hit the little fucker. "Should be safe now," I called out. Velvet Remedy entered the lab and began to search as I slumped in the corner and waited for the headache to die down some more. She was wearing her medical boxes again and started gathering supplies from the identical yellow medical boxes on the wall.
"So,"
I gasped.
"What exactly were you trying to do down in that auditorium?"
Velvet nickered.
"I already got this lecture from Calamity."
She floated bottles and vials out of a medical box, pausing as she lifted out a multi-tubed injector.
"Rage? Why would this be down here? Rage is a zebra-made combat drug."
"Not a lecture, Velvet. I want to understand. You scared the hell out of us."
"Yes, Calamity said that too. Only a little louder."
I hadn't been present for that particular argument. Calamity had flown ahead of me, rushing back to Velvet and Steelhooves after raiding Fluttershy's office. They had been given plenty of time to argue, too. I had been lost in thought, contemplating the Ministry mares, and had managed to get lost in the cubicles. "Please, Velvet," I sighed, fighting to keep my voice gentle, even with the throbbing of my head. I floated out another painkiller syringe and gave myself the shot. Almost immediately, the throbbing dulled to an ignorable level. I worried that I was seriously risking addiction to painkillers. As if to drive home that worry, Velvet Remedy floated out a tin of Mintals from the last medicine cabinet, opening it, flipping it upside down so the pills fell on the floor like heavy snow, and then began to stomp them into powder. She turned to me with an exasperated stare.
"Fluttershy was right there, little Pip. She had stood right at that spot, saying those very words. Right on that stage, Fluttershy had tried to stop the war, stop the bloodshed and the horror that ended up ruining the entire country."
Her voice hitched.
"The entire world."
She turned away from me.
"You wouldn't understand."
Alpha Technologies, the sign claimed. The heavy metal door slid back, revealing the most secure laboratories in the Ministry of Arcane Sciences.
"Steelhooves!"
Velvet Remedy and I dashed inside. Our friend was laying on a circular platform, surrounded by a magical shield. At our entrance, he stood up. I think I even detected a whinny of relief. Velvet stopped just outside the shield, looking over before asking if he was okay. Clearly, the Aliquin's attack had knocked him unconscious after all, but he'd regained it hours ago. 5.3 hours ago, according to Steelhoofs, who had nothing better to do than watch the timekeeper on his visor's EFS count away. Even if his weapons could disable the shields, the explosions would have torn him apart in that confined space. Not even Steelhoofs could survive dismemberment. I found the terminal which controlled the magical field, and began to trick my way through the security system. Soon, I was looking at the control system for the lab's several layers of security, as well as a series of project reports. I turned off the field, smiling to Steelhooves.
"Welcome back."
Velvet Remedy gave him a big hug that I knew he couldn't feel, but somehow made him look very uncomfortable anyway.
"I've collected some more medicine for your dispensary," she chimed,
and immediately looked less uncomfortable. I chuckled and directed my attention to the terminal screen, perusing the reports, starting with those which had been subdivided into a category called Ghosts. Report 347. Mosaic, or was it Gestalt, passed down a new project for Alpha today. Apparently after over 3 years of pure failure from the mayors up in spellcrafting, the Ministry Mayor has given up on the Ministry's effort to reverse engineer Zebra invisibility magic into spell form. Given our success with the stealth bug, she's passed the project on to us, requesting that we design a sustainable magic device capable of indefinite invisibility, our own version of the Zebra stealth cloak. This new project comes right on top of losing a member of the Alpha Herd. Although, from what I understand, that may make things easier on us. Officially, all I know is that Beaker has been suspended without pay. Unofficially, word had leaked down that Beaker is under investigation for accepting contributions from some pony within the Ministry of Technology in exchange for hampering development of magical energy weapons. Sounds to me like there's a pony or two in the building next door who's more concerned with Ironshot Firearms' market dominance than what's good for all the ponies of Equestria. Report 397. Another day, another pointless daily report that no pony ever reads. The shipment of drugs finally arrived from the Ministry of Morale, 3 weeks late and accompanied by two of their pink suitcase ponies who insisted on monitoring how the restricted drugs were used. And I hear there were some hard words between one of the magic twins and the Morale officials. You'd think after all the work we put into talismans for their ridiculous balloons, they'd be a bit more cooperative. End result? Even though the shipment is actually in the building, we're gonna have to wait at least 3 days while administration pushes through the paperwork before the drugs will be cleared and we can finally start the next round of tests on our prototype Steel Ranger medical dispenser. Continued efforts on improving the design and duration of Stealth Buck seem to have hit a wall. The MG Stealth Buck 2 is the most advanced design we've managed, taking advantage of the same recharging magical properties we've introduced into some of the newer lines of magical energy weapons, and possessing 4 times the duration of our original design.
However, recharging takes hours, and the duration still falls far short of our goal marks. Gestalt, or was it Mosaic, visited Alpha today to review our progress. After explaining our difficulties, she suggested we pursue a new avenue of experimentation, a stealth suit which takes advantage of multiple stealth buck arrays. While one stealth buck is providing invisibility, the others can be recharging. I passed her idea on to the rest of the Alpha herd, and we've started some preliminary sketches. This looks promising.
Report 444.
Today was a good day to be in Alpha Labs. Or, more precisely, to not be two floors above. Somehow, the mayor of the Ministry of Peace got wind of the sort of megaspell ritual chambers the ponies in spellcrafting have been designing. For such a soft-spoken and pleasant old girl, she's apparently a right terror when she gets angry. And there aren't even enough bits in the royal treasury to make it worth facing an angry ministry mayor. After spending a month calibrating the new array, the Ghost Mayor suit is ready for the first live test. As well as the turret tests, I brought in Wonder into the office today. I figure if the Ghost Mayor suit can get by my cat, we've got a winner. Twinkle and Daybreak have been particularly snippy with each other again today for no apparent reason. I suspect those two bucks are having an affair. If so, I hope they keep it quiet. Personally, I think they'd make a cute couple. But we have fraternization rules for a reason. And the last thing I want is to lose one of them because the magic twins decide to put them on different levels.
Report 445.
Wonder was a big hit in the office. Every member of Alpha Herd gathered around and utterly spoiled her with attention. A few were even insisting that I can bring her back again. I'll run it past the Magic Twins. Maybe I can spin having a lab cat as being good for morale. Sadly, the Ghost Mare suit was not as impressive. Not only did the suit fail to pass the Wonder test, but we discovered that the array was draining power from all the stealth bucks while just one of them was running. The latter is a technical design problem, I'm sure of it. The former is more worrying. We ran three members of the herd through the test gauntlet with just stealth bucks alone, and Wonder didn't catch any of them. Something in the suit, or maybe something in the array, is weakening the visibility spell somehow. Fortunately, we have time to try to fix this before the next review. No ponies paying attention to us down here with the big mess upstairs. Apparently Fluttershy went to Twilight Sparkle, and now the Magic Twins are cleaning house. I don't get the politics involved here, but I do get that 24 unicorns have been fired already, and this is just the first day. Another dozen have actually quit, taking up an offer from the Ministry of Peace. I've even heard rumors that they might be planning to dismantle some of the chambers, or redesign them for purely defensive spells like the Ministry of Peace is demanding. But I don't put any stock in that gossip. Equestria isn't going to disarm itself in the middle of a war, especially not after the Zebras successfully tested a mega spell of their own last week.
Report 489.
Thanks to Wonder, we've finally gotten insight onto one of the issues plaguing the Ghost Mare suit project. Apparently, the magic of Zebra stealth cloaks is also designed to mitigate sound and smell. During the development of stealth bucks, we had noticed the difference in the muffling effect from Zebra's artifacts and our own devices. We had written this off as an acceptable loss, particularly since the cloak's original sound dampening effect was a relatively minor effect to begin with. We had not, however, noticed the olfactory effect. This was apparently of greater concern to the Zebras, possibly on account of the plethora of dangerous wildlife rumored to exist in their homeland. Further proof that Zebras are innately crazy. Could you imagine living in Equestria if it was full of roaming monsters? While the original stealth buck still retains at least a fraction of this effect, the MG Stealth Buck 2 does not. Or, more precisely, does not after its first use. For reasons still a mystery to us, the element of the spell refuses to function after the Stealth Buck 2 recharges. Twinkle let something slip today about he and Daybreak getting a cat. I made a seemingly off-hoofed comment about cats having a tendency to reveal things that should be kept secret. I hope he got the hint.
Report 512.
The Ghost Mare suit project has suffered another setback today. I'm amazed at how something so simple in concept can be so resistant to proper execution. I spent all last month solving the mutual depletion problem only to find that the new array can't pass the stress test. The Ghost Mare suit isn't worth anything if it can't sustain invisibility after a 1-yard fall. A few of the other researchers here in the Alpha Herd have begun referring to this as Project Frustration. Unfortunately, with other projects beginning to pile up, I'm gonna have to take most of my ponies off this one, down-prioritizing it till things look a little more promising for us. Fortunately, Gestalt and Mosaic are out of Canterlot today, having an on-site meeting with Twilight Sparkle at the new facility out in Splendid Valley. Honestly, I breathe a little easier when they aren't around. I personally find the Magic Twins a little creepy, particularly the way they finish each other's sentences. Doesn't any pony else get the shivers when they do that? It's as if Mosaic and Gestalt always know exactly what the other sister is thinking. Like they're not so much twins as one mare stuck in two bodies. Okay, no more reading ghosts, goblins, and ghoulish figures on my break time. Report 550. Twilight Sparkle paid a surprise visit to the Alpha Lab today. To my dismay, she asked for an update on the Ghost Mare Suit Project. She'd apparently hoped we were much further along, and had wanted to bring in Rarity, the mayor of the Ministry of Image. What the hell? For a consultation on the suit's aesthetic design. Seriously, the suit's supposed to be invisible. Who the hell cares what it looks like? Twilight Sparkle asked me to put up with the nuisance anyway and give Rarity our full attention and respect. Afterwards, Daybreak suggested Twilight Sparkle was looking for a way to cheer up her friend, saying something afterwards about Rarity having been a dressmaker. Honestly, I have no idea how dumping more work on some pony in that position, particularly if it's pointless work, could possibly cheer a pony up. On the other hoof, the idea that one of the ministry mares might be suffering wartime stress disorder is terrifying, so I told Daybreak to keep that opinion carefully under wraps. While Twilight Sparkle was disappointed with our progress on that particular project, at least she was understanding. And she was considerably more pleased with our other projects, such as the multi-gem heavy infantry battle saddle. Alpha Labs has continued to show a great deal of success in other projects, so I don't think we'll face any repercussions. She did, however, ask if there was any pony I believe we could spare to join the spellcrafting lab above us. Apparently they're researching something called a bypass spell, and have reached the point where they need a fresh mind. I told her I'd get back to her on that. Tomorrow, I'm gonna have a talk with Daybreak and Twinkle. I would prefer to keep both of them, as they're excellent members of the herd. But if I'm gonna end up losing one of them, I would rather it be done this way. I stopped skimming the reports. There were dozens more in Ghost alone, and half a dozen other categories. Getting up, I looked around at the lab, opening locked storage containers and equipment lockers. Oh, Calamity would be sorry he was missing out on this. There were tools in here I couldn't even guess the purpose of. I checked to make sure Velvet was still busy with steel hose, reasoning that it wasn't sightseeing if I had to wait anyway. Then levitated a duffel bag out from under one of the tables. Pulling it open and dumping out the empty cat carrier inside, I started scooping random tools and equipment into a duffel bag.
"Ready to go, little Pip?"
Velvet called out. Yeah, just 1 minute," I called back, cutting my scavenging short. But there was still one storage container I wanted to raid before we descended into the basement. The one where I'd spotted the prototype Ghostmare suit. Or, at least parts of it. The project had clearly never been completed, and was abandoned in the middle of a complete overhaul. Now, digging back to the container, I found something that was worth taking.
Maybe you could repair it and you could have your own Ghostmare suit! Yeah!
1 MG Stealth Buck 2. With a grunt, Steelhills forced open the elevator doors, and the three of us looked down the dark shaft. Midway down, a field of blue energy cut horizontally across the shaft, blocking our way down. I sighed, unsurprised. We tried to find the stairwell to the basement already, only to find the thick metal door had slid into place, cutting off access. The entire basement was locked down tight. The only way in was to be teleported there by the Ministry's building security, and I had yet to find a way out.
"Look at those cables," Velvet whispered. "They go right down through the shield."
I nodded. I'd figured the shield had been closed around them, although it was a little surprising they hadn't been severed. "What are you thinking?"
"Bypass spell,"
she responded. "For the cables?"
"For the whole elevator,"
she suggested.
"I know it's a long shot, but..."
Steelos nickered disbelievingly.
"You think they put a security barrier in the elevator shaft that the elevator could get through?"
I bit my lower lip in thought. "Actually, that's not as silly as it sounds. The elevator would be programmed to move to the bottom when the basement was locked down. but they wouldn't want to try to trap any ponies, so they set the barrier to allow the elevator through. That way the barrier can activate instantly while the elevator has time to deposit any passengers on the floors above.
I was talking out my tailside, but it made at least some sense.
Once the elevator reaches the bottom, the power is cut in the whole system, and the elevator is locked up into position.
So what good does that do us?
Steelos asked.
Velvet almost purred. They weren't planning on Little Pip, now were they?
I knew what she was getting at. Levitate the elevator up to us, get on, and down we go. Only one problem.
I need schematics of the elevator's mechanical system, I told them.
Velvet looked at me oddly.
Why? What for? The locking mechanism is at the bottom where I can't see it.
She continued to look at me blankly. I sighed.
Look, I need to know what I'm doing before I can do it.
I looked at them both. Of course they didn't understand. Steelos had no clue about magic at all, and Velvet Remedy's levitation magic was comparatively foolish.
It's the same reason I can telekinetically fire a gun or pull the power supply from a turret, even if I can't see it. But I can't just use my magic to squeeze some pony's heart or build a rifle while blindfolded. If I can't see what I'm doing, I need to at least be able to picture it in my mind with a fair amount of accuracy, or the magic won't manifest, I explained, hoping I didn't sound patronizing. I need a place to start if I have any chance of doing this. Like with the star spawn. Until Pyrolite set part of it on fire, I didn't have any place to begin. In this case, since I have no idea what kind of locking mechanism I might not be seeing, I need the schematics.
Velvet Remedy and Steelos both nodded.
Want schematics for the elevator coming right up.
Oh, goddesses.
Velvet Remedy whimpered.
Little Pip.
I was studying the elevator schematic Steelos had found on my pip buck. Velvet had been watching me, and I realized what she had just seen. I looked at her, then looked away and nodded. I didn't have anything to say on the matter. Steelos whinnied. I put up a hoof, signaling for him to say nothing. I didn't know if his words would be, I told you so, or a guilt-laden apology, but I didn't think I could handle either one of those. I had saved him. It had cost me a bit of my poniness. What was done was done. I couldn't say I didn't regret it, but I could say I would do it again, even knowing the outcome.
Really,
I said, feeling a hitch in my throat.
It's not that bad. I hardly notice the itch anymore.
I shifted my attention to the shaft and the elevator below. I focused, reaching out, attempting to manifest my magic on the far side of the shield. This was a bit of a new trick, but there was no reason it shouldn't work. I remembered the Super Alicorn from the Philadelphia crater, whose shield was so powerful she couldn't manifest magic through it. This shield was nothing compared to that one. I thought of Velvet Remedy casting her anesthetic spell inside of the Alicorn's shield. I could do this. I was satisfied to see the glow of my magic surround the elevator car. I focused on the thick yet simple clamps, rotating the screws that held them together until I heard them fall apart. Concentrating, I slowly lifted the elevator car upwards, pulling it towards the energy shield. I held my breath as the top of the car reached the field of blue light. Moment of truth. Was Velvet right? The car continued to lift, gliding through the field as if it was nothing but a film of water. I exhaled gratefully. In moments, it was hovering in front of us. I pushed the car's clattering gate open.
Fillies and gentle colts,
I announced with a sweeping bow.
Your chariot awaits.
Well, that was cheesy.
As I floated the elevator car down towards the basement, Velvet Remedy and I rode alone. The three of us had barely gotten onto the elevator when we realized the problem. With Steelhove's extra bulk, there was barely enough room for the three of us. There was no way we'd be able to fit Calamity in two. Or maneuver, as Steelos pointed out, if there was a turret waiting for us at the bottom. Instead, we had left our Steel Ranger outcast standing guard over Calamity's packs, duffel bag, and most of our weapons. Calamity would just have to wait a little while to put his battle saddle back on. I touched my forehead tentatively. I stared at the floor of the elevator. Finally, I asked Velvet Remedy,
Little Macintosh?
Velvet Remedy hissed.
Wrong question.
I was startled by the vehemence in her voice.
You should have asked about Pyrolite.
Oh. I felt a twinge of guilt.
Pyrolite's not in the building according to the security system. She never got trapped in.
I stopped, feeling a sinking sensation that chilled my heart and stole my breath. The elevator car stopped with a jolt as my eyes widened. If Pyrolite never made it inside, that meant she was still out of the pink. A whole night in the cloud meant certain death.
I asked her to go get your things, as I brought Seelos inside,
Velvet said morosely.
But I got magically thrown in that prison, that chamber, before I could prompt the door open for her.
Velvet looked at me with a heartbreaking expression.
I have to imagine she gathered little Macintosh and all your precious weapons, ported them someplace, and then sat outside and waited for me.
I cringed, a whimper strangling in my throat. But Velvet shook her head.
Pyrolite's a smart bird. She's a survivor. I have to believe she wouldn't wait too long. That she'd fly out of the cloud, out of Canterlot. Maybe all the way back to Glyphmark and Zenith.
She turned away, but I saw the drops fall from her, making damp spots on the floor.
As long as the pink cloud doesn't get worse too quickly, as long as she wasn't taken by surprise, I have to believe that.
Speaking with confidence I didn't really have, I assured her that she was all right. I started the elevator downward again.
Tell me where it is,
the mayor's voice called out, grating across my brain. My ears had popped. Clink.
No!
The Trixie-like second voice echoed in my head. The air shimmered around us. My lungs fought for breath.
Oh no.
Clink, clank.
Unchain us! Your goddess demands it!
Velvet Remedy and I slithered across the tiled basement floor, pushing aside toppled boxes of grain and shattered plates, dropped kitchen knives, and leaking packages of flour. At first, we crouched to be stealthy, but now we did it just to breathe.
No, if I enchain us, you'll kill us both. You're trying to kill me already. Better we should both perish.
Clink, clank, clink. I coughed, my abused lungs struggling for air. The sound was high and tight, not like a pony's cough at all, and that worried me. I coughed again, and Velvet Remedy did the same. Her coughs more like a newborn squeak toy than any noise which should have come from Velvet's throat. We both froze, ears perking and swiveling as we prayed the kitchen's other occupant hadn't heard us.
We must throw the party. Our goddess demands it.
The alicorn hadn't heard us. She was too busy arguing with, as far as I could tell, herself. I reached the end of the counter and peeked around it cautiously. The forest green alicorn was wrapped in heavy chains that bound her to a thick set of pipes in the ceiling. She stood there, looking around frantically, searching for something, a frightened but intelligent look in her eyes. Suddenly, her demeanor changed, her eyes looking forward with a glare, and her face contorting in rage. She lunged, throwing herself against the chains that bound her. Clank, clank, clink.
I am your goddess!
The Trixie-like voice raged. It wasn't the actual voice of the goddess, but some strange, pale imitation that echoed through my head. I realized her mouth wasn't moving. Everything I was hearing was in my head. All of it. But how was that possible? The pink cloud hindered Alicorn's telepathy. I was sure of it. It cut them off from their goddess, allowing them to regain some of their individuality again. Granted, while the kitchens were full of some sort of gas, it wasn't pink cloud. But there was pink cloud all around this building. Even as I thought that, my eyes drifted into the alicorn's flank and caught there. The alicorn had a cutie mark. It looked odd, like maybe a mist of stars, but I couldn't be sure. The mere fact that the alicorn had one at all shook my conceptions. The alicorn's flank quivered with effort as she lunged again, the chains pulling taut, holding her back. I followed her gaze. It looked like she was trying to get to the ovens.
I helped you. I was there for you when she was silent. I whispered to you when you couldn't bear the silence in your head. I coddled you. Me, not her.
The not-Trixie voice ranted.
And you betray me. I will kill you for that.
Without the goddess, I had surmised that the Alicorns were cut off from their collective pool of magic. That they were left with just their inherent magics, the Alicorns' shields, and maybe a spell or two. I had to revise that theory. Or not. Purple Alicorns teleport. Blue ones turn invisible. The green ones did that weird statue thing. But what if that was part of a broader gift? The green Alicorns were telepaths. Even cut off from the goddess, they still had their gift. If anything, the goddess probably borrowed that magical talent from them. I felt Velvet Remedy slide past me, slipping ahead. I looked back at the Alicorn. This was our mission. The original voice was back. The Alicorn stopped struggling and resumed her search. I froze again as she looked right past me and missed me. The Alicorn was showing greater tier obliviousness. We're so close now. I will not fail. I watched her muzzle, but her mouth never moved. This whole argument was taking place in her head, and by extension, in ours. Then I saw something that rocked me. The Alicorn's cutie mark had faded away, reminding me of Ophelia in my magic class at Stable 2 who tried to have her father conjure up her cutie mark early by using magic. Each time, a new mark would appear, only to fade away, just like this.
That's a reference to Season 1. Season 1.
Cutie mark of a flask with bubbling green liquid replaced it. The Alicorn's new cutie mark struck a chord of deja vu. I'd seen it before. A moment later, the Alicorn's demeanor changed again, and as I watched, the bubbling flask cutie mark faded and a starry mist resumed its place. Why? Why go back to her? I'm better. I'm here only for you. Always. A series of rattles filled the air as the Alicorn struggled against her bindings once more. I began to crawl away, shaken and a little freaked out by what I had seen. Your cutie mark is an integral part of you, a symbol of your special talent. How could it change like that? Even when you were depressed, even when you were at your worst, you were still you. Your cutie mark never abandoned you. And I'm better at magic, too. She said it couldn't be done. No small rodents of any kind, she said. But I did it. I'm the one who found the spell. And I'm the one that cast it while you whimpered in a corner.
God, what is going on?
In the far corner of a small cell, behind both a magical shield and a locked gate. I had to hold my breath while I hacked the security terminal that dropped the shield. At even a yard up, the air became impossible to breathe. Cracking the computer took me several tries. It was difficult to concentrate, especially with the Alicorn's telepathic argument being broadcast non-stop into my head. The moment the shield vanished, Velvet and I scrambled on our bellies to his cell. Velvet reached her hooves between the bars, touching them to his as he slid close.
Don't even try it,
he squeaked, seeing me eye the lock. I froze, not from his warning, but the high-pitched, squeaky voice that had come out of his mouth.
Helium!
Hydrogen.
Oh, hydrogen.
The air's full of it. One spark from your gun or your horn and we're all roast.
It was like listening to a small woodland creature, only cuter and sillier. I snorted, trying to hold in a laugh. I tried to distract myself from the seriousness of our situation. You'd think, the terminal entry had said, after all the work we put into our talismans for the ridiculous balloons, they'd be a bit more cooperative. The Ministry of Magic had created hydrogen talismans for the Ministry of Morale. There was probably one in the high security storage down here, and it had been activated. But if I couldn't use our weapons or magic, how was I going to get Calamity's cell open?
Better figure out something fast, little Pip.
The woodland critter voice coming from Calamity insisted.
This place is gonna be unbreathable, give it an hour. I reckon the only reason it took this long is because this place is huge.
I covered my muzzle with both forebows, tears in my eyes.
I can't mention of there being a hangar down here,
he added squeakily. That did it. I couldn't hold it in anymore. Despite my difficulty breathing, I found myself laughing so hard I was rolling on the floor. The high-pitched sounds of my own laughter just made me guffaw harder.
Yeah, yuck up, why don't you?
Calamity glowered at me. And now, even Velvet was laughing.
but would one of you kindly get the damn key and get me out of here before that alicorn drives me crazy?
Seriously, seriously, that's hilarious.
I stomped a hoof on the floor, dying.
Sing us something first.
Velvet Remy suggested, her own voice even higher. Calamity just snorted, laughing at Velvet in response. Ah, thank y'all, Calamity said as he slipped something pink into his backpack. I blinked, realizing he'd managed to pilfer something even under those conditions. Now let's get out of here before the crazy lady downstairs manages to blow this building up to the Enclave, Calamity suggested urgently as he shrugged on his battle saddle, his voice almost back to normal. Velvet Remedy looked fretfully back at the empty elevator shaft.
I wish I had some way to help her, she said softly.
What? Help the crazy alicorn? What for? Velvet Remedy gave Calamity a stern look.
She's obviously suffering. Can you imagine having someone in your head as a constant companion for lifetimes, and then suddenly losing her? I saw her cutie marks.
Marks? Calamity asked. As in, plural? Velvet nodded.
One of them was from one of the ponies whose videos the goddess showed us. I believe that alicorn was one of the first. She had the goddess in her mind for centuries.
Velvet looked back to the elevator again.
Then, to come here and suddenly lose that, I'm not surprised she was traumatized. I'm surprised more aren't.
Calamity raised his eyebrows. So the pink cloud is making alicorns insane, right? That settles it. We need to get to the castle.
What?
Please go to the castle. Please go to the castle. I want to know what happened to the princesses.
We were galloping through the lobby. Panting, I stopped and looked out at the wall of pink cloud. It wasn't lethally thick yet, not like the places where it pooled, but it was bad enough to filter out most of the light. It was past dawn, and yet it looked like it was past dusk. Was there anything he could have said, maybe? I wondered, seeing how distraught Velvet was beginning to look. Pyrolite was nowhere in sight, which was a good thing, realistically, but it had to be feeding her distress. The pretty unicorn mare shook her head, her white mane and its colored stripes whipping about.
No, little Pip. The only way to help the poor thing now is with years of therapy, she said, looking at me sadly. You can't heal true psychological trauma with a super restoration potion, or the quick conversation of pretty words and psychobabble.
I was right, Calamity announced. I hate to say I told you so, but, nah, after that singing bit, I'm downright happy to say I told you so. He landed at the front doors of the Ministry of Arcane Sciences and stared at us. So, I told you so.
Told us what?
Velvet asked politely as we trotted up to him. What singing? Steele's question. I found myself snickering again. Calamity nickered, rolling his eyes. The zebra's mega spell. It's still going. Sorta. I stopped snickering.
Where is it? What do you mean, sort of?
Velvet questioned. We should leave this building, Steele's reminded us. Calamity nodded to him. Right. I'll tell you when we get next door. It was morning. We'd lost a good chunk of a day, and the pink cloud was going to be thick enough that we wanted to take the rest of the journey in small bites. Next door to the Ministry of Technology, then across to the Ministry of Image. Finally, from there to the Ministry of Awesome. Hopefully, the rest of the Ministry buildings will be more like the Ministry of Peace than this one. We opened the door and charged through the pink cloud. The distance we'd crossed was less than a city block. I was sure we could easily make it with no distractions.
Look over there,
Velvet shouted, pointing to one of the garbage bins alongside the building. There was a smear on it that looked like a flame. I groaned inwardly, rolling my eyes, and trotted over to it. Calamity was faster and had already opened it by the time I got there. Inside were our weapons and gear. Pyrolite had stashed them in a bin and marked it. With bird shit. Not wanting to risk leaving anything behind,
I pulled
the contents of the garbage bin out and carried it with us, refuse and all. The alicorns were upon us, their shields up before we made it halfway. Stelos turned and opened fire, but Spitfire's thunder was somewhere in a mass of rotten rubbish floating behind me, and none of the weapons we had at the ready could penetrate those shields. So we ran, panting, galloping for the doors of the Ministry.
Oh, there goes Spitfire's thunder.
The doors were glass. The entire front facade of the Ministry was glass, a matrix of clear panes that rose 3 stories high. The rest of the building had an elegant simplicity, stately, functional, with an almost masculine grace. The king on the chessboard. I hoped the glass was enforced somehow, otherwise the Alicorns would just plow right through it. The steps up to the Ministry building were piled with the skeletons of long dead ponies. I raced by a unicorn stallion whose hooves had sunk into the concrete steps, and jumped to the body of a younger mare whose bones had taken on the pattern of the dress she'd been wearing on the day of the pink cloud. I noticed the jumble of skeletons blanking the marble floor inside the Ministry's grand foyer as well, but I didn't think anything of it until I telekinetically pulled open the glass doors and charged into a flood of static. I screamed as fresh but familiar agony skewered my brain. I stumbled and turned towards the exit, only to see my friends race into the room and all but Stelos get slammed to the floor. Outside, the Alicorns landed, closing the doors and stood there, holding them closed with their shields. We even herded into a trap. I looked around, dropping the garbage I was carrying onto the skeletons of several dead ponies as I frantically searched. I almost immediately spotted 3, and before I could focus enough to pull up a weapon, I'd spotted 2 more.
There are dozens.
Velvet Remedy squealed, clutching her head, blood running out of her eyes and ears. Lashing out with my magic, I tried to wrap up all the skeletons, intending to toss the whole contents of the room up onto one of the mezzanines above. Excruciating torture ripped through my horn, blackening my vision. Somewhere, I heard a voice shouting, "Shut him down!" Then, for the second time in half a day, I passed out. I was locked into what seemed like the longest, most boring memory ever. My host was skimming over sheets of paperwork, non-disclosure contracts, agreements to drug and loyalty testing, acceptance of possible mandatory relocation, and so on. Each sheet bore a large emblem, a star ringed by smaller ones and circumscribed by a horn and wings. Each had the header of an official Ministry of Arcane Technologies document. My host was either a speed reader, or she wasn't really reading that closely. Occasionally, she would look up, glancing sheepishly at the bored mayor sitting behind her desk, or watching the door behind the desk. The first time she did so, I realized I knew where we were by the fanciful design of the door and the ornate lighting. This was Ten Pony Tower. My host never looked up long, though, before returning to the clipboard filled with paperwork. Every so often, she would levitate a quill, dipping it in ink, and sign her name. Trixie. We looked up, Trixie and I, when the door opened and a smiling Twilight Sparkle stepped out.
Trixie, I'm very happy you could make it.
I wouldn't have missed this opportunity for the world. We quickly signed the last page and floated the clipboard to the mayor at the desk, who was now sitting at the sort of alert attention that only comes from ponies who were slacking just before their boss walked in.
Please, come on in,
Twilight said, standing aside. Slowly, almost humbly, Trixie stepped through the doorway. Inside was a nice office, not ostentatious in the slightest, mostly filled with shelves holding books and various knick-knacks of magical or personal importance. As Trixie's eyes wandered over the room, I spotted a jar with several delicate purple-spotted lavender shards floating in preserving liquid. The jar was labeled Spike's Egg. Twilight Sparkle walked in behind us, closing the door and moving around to sit at her desk.
Spike's Egg.
She looked over the desk with a slight frown and, apparently deciding it seemed too formal, walked back around the desk and sat on a floor cushion, offering another to Trixie.
Miss Sparkle?
Trixie began. I could feel her nervousness.
Oh, please, come on, call me Twilight, she beamed. So, tell me, been working on any new tricks lately?
I felt my host stammer for a moment, then draw herself up, breathing deeply. With a prideful voice, she boasted.
Why, yes. In fact, just the other day, I invented an invisibility spell. Would you like to see?
Twilight Sparkle blinked.
You invented an invisibility spell? Indeed. Have you ever known another unicorn who could do this?
I felt the surge of magic as my host cast her spell. Twilight Sparkle gasped.
You... Trixie! You're actually invisible?
Twilight reached out, prodding us with a hoof, making sure we were actually still there and hadn't teleported away.
That's amazing!
I felt the spell ebb, then collapse. It clearly wasn't long-lasting. Still, Trixie sat up, smiling broadly.
See? Am I not still the great and powerful Trixie?
Twilight gazed at her.
I admit, I'm impressed.
As seconds ticked by, I could feel sweat bead on my forehead.
And you invented the spell all by yourself? Why, yes, I...
All at once, Trixie seemed to deflate.
No.
She stared at the floor, scuffing with her hoof.
I mean, yes, I created the spell, but only after I got a hold of one of those new stealth bugs and figured out how to cast the magic myself.
Twilight's expression softened.
Thanks for being honest with me, Trixie.
Trixie nodded.
I'll see myself out now. No.
Twilight said swiftly.
No, it's okay. It's all right. I'm still really impressed. Those stealth bugs were created by my ministry.
Trixie winced.
And we reverse-engineered those from Zebra Magic. But none of my unicorns have been able to recreate it in spell form. I have a whole division in Canterlot who has spent years trying to do what you just did, and failing.
Trixie looked up again, surprised.
Yeah!
I felt a burning in her eyes. She was holding back tears.
What you've done is incredible. You should be proud. And don't be nervous. You've already got the job.
Twilight Sparkle smiled.
That is, if you still want it. I hope all that out there didn't put you off.
Oh no, not at all, Trixie said hurriedly.
I really want to work for the ministry. Your ministry.
Then, in a softer voice,
and I need this job. Oh dear.
Twilight's eyes widened.
Trixie, what happened?
Well, you know, she sighed.
Things didn't go so well for me after Ponyville. I lost my home. Word spread about how you defeated the Ursa Minor and how I...
She shook her head.
I was a laughingstock. Only I was too proud and blind to see it. My show started bringing jeers instead of cheers. And then they stopped bringing any pony at all. Money ran out. No pony would hire the great and powerful Trixie. I had to take unpleasant jobs.
Trixie looked aside.
Things actually got better for me when the war started. Pony stopped caring about my reputation. It was long enough ago, and they had other things to hate at this point. Oh, Trixie. Trixie, I never knew.
Trixie looked into Twilight's concerned expression, then at the floor.
Honestly, I'm surprised you would want me here.
Twilight smiled.
Well, I remember you as a skilled and talented unicorn with an impressive repertoire of spells. I'm happy to have you with us. I've got a new project, and I need volunteers.
She paused.
There is one thing, though. You'll have to allow us to record one of your memories.
Trixie's eyes widened.
You want to see my memories?
Twilight Sparkle shook her head.
No, just one of them. And the memory of this meeting will do just fine.
Trixie looked askance.
This one, well, that's not so bad then, but why? This war,
Twilight Sparkle explained,
will be won by the side with superior magic. We're working on a potion that will transform a normal pony into...
She paused, then spit it out.
Into an alicorn.
Trixie gasped.
And no, I'm not joking. We're ready to test it. And I wanted to ask you to be the first.
Twilight Sparkle looked nervous. She understood the gravity of what she was asking my host, even if Trixie really did not.
An alicorn? You mean like Princess Celestia?
And Princess Luna, yes.
Twilight's tone was very serious.
This is transformation magic of the highest order. We need a memory of yours for comparison, before and after. We don't think that being changed into an alicorn will affect your psyche, but we can't be sure.
With that, she put a gentle hoof on Trixie.
We've taken every precaution. I wouldn't ask any pony to do this if I wasn't absolutely sure it
would happen. Oh, guess what, Twilight? You're only half correct.
Still, I know it's asking a lot. Too much. This potion would change who you are. What you are.
Trixie gulped.
If you don't want to do this, you can back out at any time. It's fine by me.
Twilight Sparkle smiled.
And I promise, you'll still have a job within the Ministry. I'll make sure of it.
Trixie was silent for a long time. I could feel a tremor pass through her. But then, slowly and softly, she said,
I'll do it. I don't mind being changed. I'm not the greatest fan of who I am anymore. Haven't been for a long time.
Man, now you're making me feel sorry for Trixie maybe, again.
Maybe this way I'll actually be able to be who I thought I was.
Twilight Sparkle's eyes danced with joy.
Then welcome to the Ministry of Arcane Sciences, Trixie. If you don't mind, I'd like to get started right away.
Twilight Sparkle stood up abruptly, moving towards the door.
Are you free for the rest of the weekend? I'd like you to come out to Maripony with me. I've got a couple of ponies who I really want you to meet.
She let out a little squee.
Oh, I can't wait to see their faces when you turn invisible.
Who? Trixie asked as my host got up, trotting after her. Twilight turned back with a smile.
Gestalt and Mosaic. They're my head researchers. Twins and some of the most amazing spellcasters you'll ever meet.
With a sheepish grin.
Next to you and I, of course. I normally leave them in charge of my ministry helping Canterlot, but they're at Maripony now, overseeing the final preparations. You'll like them. They have a cute way of finishing each other's sentences.
Twilight grinned.
Anyone hear something really impressive? I've seen them finish each other's spells, too.
Finish each other's thoughts, and each other's spells. The foundations for telepathy and spell sharing. An epiphany washed over me. I suddenly understood why there were three breeds of alicorn, why they had the abilities they did, even why all alicorns were female. Dozens of ponies were absorbed into what became the goddess, but it was Trixie's mind which became dominant. The behavior of my host wasn't much like that of the goddess, but there were shadows of her here. The goddess was lurking in some distant part of her psyche, waiting to be tapped. But it wasn't just Trixie who held power. There were four ponies within the amalgam that formed the goddess who were powerful enough to exert influence over the alicorn creation process. Blue is invisibility. Purple can teleport. The greens are telepathic and can work together to create greater effects with their shields. Four ponies, all mares. I wondered, if the goddess consumed me, would a new breed of alicorns begin with extra powerful telekinetics?
So that explains it. That explains a lot. That's why they're color-coded. Because the green ponies are based on the twins who can finish each other's spells and work telepathically. And I know I'm repeating what he just said, whatever. But seriously, this is a very important note. Like, and purple from Twilight comes from Twilight's genetics. And that's the reason why the purple ones can teleport. And the blue ones are able to turn invisible just like Trixie can. So that explains it. So much.
Alicorn stallions. My thoughts were interrupted as Trixie stopped, asking nervously.
And they'll be impressed with me? Oh, I guarantee it, Trixie. They'll love you.
Okay. Oh, anyway, that was the end of the chapter. But I hope you guys enjoyed this chapter, because this answered so many questions that I've been asking for so long. And that explain. And by the looks of it, that alicorn that was in there, that was probably those twins. That exact one. So, anyway, I hope you guys enjoy this, and I hope to see you guys more in my videos, because this is my most popular series, and you guys are apparently just loving the commentary, or you're just loving me listening to the story, or whatever you're watching it for. But anyway, guys, I hope to catch you guys in the next video, and stay nerdy, my friends. Bye!